Quick introduction. So first of all, thank you for coming out tonight to the San Francisco Internet of Things Meetup. So my name is Alfred, and two of my co-organizers, Dorothy and Louis, started this meetup about 6 months ago now. The goal of this meetup is really to bring together four groups of people, designers, developers, both software and hardware, entrepreneurs, and also data scientists. We wanted to bring them together to explore this new medium called Internet of Things. And we've been running monthly events pretty consistently, and all of them is always in the city and around Internet of Things. So this month, we are lucky enough to be hosted by DesignMap in this amazing studio. So I want to give the partner of DesignMap, Audrey, a few minutes to introduce DesignMap to you guys.
I think so too. Somebody is that possible? Technically, one of you guys.
Music?
Are you? Yes. All right. I'll go turn it off afterwards. Anyway, thank you guys so much for coming. We're DesignMap. Several of you were kind enough to walk up to me and say, "Where am I? And who are you? What do you do?" And that's good feedback for me because we're just learning how to do this. We're kind of being this stuff. So we're a small 20-person design firm. We do interaction and visual design. That's kind of all we do. We work with small businesses and enterprise trying to solve wicked hard problems, like getting 100 designers and developers in a room on a beautiful evening like this. And we put special emphasis on helping, partnering with our clients to get successful products to market. So we have clients like eBay, and we're very excited to have a client like ExactTarget that just got acquired by Salesforce. So that's what we do. Is that a good answer to that question? I am supposed to say some things. And one of them is to thank Sour Flour, who provided the bread. And they're doing some really cool stuff. They're a community-based organization that's sharing bread and empowering people and teaching people to make bread. And they have a website, which is sourflower.org. They're a nonprofit. And I'm supposed to thank the cheese lady, but I she's here. There's cheese. But don't go. There's cheese, but don't go away. Enjoy it later, because we're going to still be here after talking. So that's Orland Farmstead Creamery, and they do everything by hand. So everything by hand, like removing the curds from the whey, unpackaging the cheese. And they have a Kickstarter campaign so that I think is a mind-blowingly cool mashup of like, we do everything that men, except for you have a Kickstarter campaign. So you can look them up there. It's Orland Camp, Armstead Creamery, and Valerie Sutton. We don't think it's staying, but it's over yonder leaving us cheats. So anything else? Is that it? All right, thanks you guys. Thanks for coming.
All right, so this is probably the only piece that we'll ask you to do tonight. So one thing that we really want to do is to bring the community together. So what we do when we started actually a few events ago is to just have everybody just do a quick shout out of what they do. Just raise your hand, we'll pass along the mic, who you are, what you do, give it another 10 seconds so we can quickly go through the entire room. All right, let's do this.
All right, I'm Marcel, and I'll be explaining what I do in just a couple of minutes, I guess.
Hi, my name is Ronald. I'm an engineer here in the city. Marcel is my former student from Holland. I'm a former co-worker for 10 years.
10 years.
Yeah. Anna Pizarro, I'm from New York, and I'm an entrepreneur.
I'm from Mission Designer, KKD, I'm a freelancer, background graphic design, communication, and graphics. And I'm looking for programmers for the Study Show on Decal Academy, so come and talk to me if you want.
Hi, I'm Aisha, and I do design research.
I'm Casper, I'm visiting from the Netherlands, I'm a change maker.
I'm Rose, and I'm a PhD student in biophysics and martial arts
philosophy. Hi, I'm Alice, and I'm also a friend of Marcel and both and Ron, and I'm a kids' web designer.
Hi, I'm Gary at CoupleWise.com, and I'm the CEO of CoupleWise, and we're looking for any UI, UX designers that we'd like to use. Web and mobile technology to make couples happier. Ooh. And see Audrey, if you know anybody, it could be just do a usability audit. I'm giving the pinch now because I bet it'll be great. Make a huge difference in people's lives. Thanks.
I'm Mike Lanza. I'm a five-time entrepreneur. This is my sixth I'm working on. It's the area of Internet of Things and location-based games.
Hi, I'm Steven. I lead the technology group at an industrial design firm called Youth Project here in the city a few blocks away. We do a lot of hardware and software prototyping, a lot of work with C++ and Arduino, and controllers, and sensor networks, all these sorts of things. So. I work at Newman, I'm a developer, I'm also looking to figure out how to develop websites and stuff.
Hi, I'm Linda, and I'm a designer and creative director. I'm always looking for someone to put in bed or explain the class.
Hi, I'm Owen, and I normally manage render farms and storage and IT and video stuff, but I like to be involved in Internet of Things and would love to talk to anybody who has done many, many things.
I'm Norris. I'm a company at Tesla Motors. I'm a big fan of Internet of Things, and I'm Dutch, so I'm very excited to see this presentation.
Richard Anderson, I'm a user experience strategy consultant.
I'm Phil, a Virginia researcher working on the Internet of Big Things, like planes, trains, and power plants. We're also looking for interaction science.
I'm Vivian, I'm a design strategist, happen to it. I'm also an artist and founder of Internet of Things Technology to one of the X.
I'm Julian, I'm people at the University of Philadelphia. And I like Internet of Things.
Hi, Hi, my name is Lauren. I actually came for the cheese, but actually, I'm just interested. Came with a friend, so I do sales, so completely different, but very interested.
Hi, I'm Jeremy. I'm an entrepreneur in residence at an accelerator called Startup Bootcamp, and
hey, I'm John. I'm an industrial designer and a user experience researcher. When I see user experience, I'm actually talking about hardware user experience, so way people have to build interact with hardware devices. I'm also launching a online project with travel guides at the moment. So I'm looking for a marketing social media program.
Hi, Wendy. I'm Emma. I'm also a designer. And,
Hi,
I'm Kika. I'm basic code. I'm a designer and developer for the IoT.
I'm Jeffrey. I'm the CEO of the basic code. And I'm doing my job with
the project. I'm Josh. I'm from the past college. We do software engineering.
Hi,
just speak loud. I think we're too.
So, I'm with a company called Lucria. And quick pitch, Mucria is a design and development iOS and Android. And we've been working a lot of startup from here. We've been on the path and started with a couple of others. We're trying to partner with a design firm, actually, a friend of mine, IoT. So I'm looking for any other awesome design firm. Perfect segue into the IDO. I'm Marcel from my interaction designer. I'm not looking for anyone but two people on top of me. I'm very trying to I'm Barton. Just with the statement. I'm
Michael Foster, building tools for the open source internet.
Good to see you again.
Mike Nyowski, I wrote a book on designing and interacting called Smart Things, and I am a part where we are inventing a hero and you.
Thanks.
Hi, I'm Beth. I am a
Hi, I'm Matt. I'm a community manager at Logicam. We include all hardware and software platforms for.
Hi, my name is Sean.
All right.
Okay, my name is Sonny. I'm Karen. I'm an interactive designer. I'm a software.
Guys, I'm Natalie. I'm an interactive designer at Smart Design. I'm going to be working in
I'm
employed by the company. And then,
speaker. Marcel, I will let him pronounce his last name for you because I have tried, couldn't do it. So Marcel came all the way from Rotterdam to speak to us today. He is the founder of The Incredible Machine, an agency specialized in crafting beautiful products and the digital services to make them meaningful. So without further ado, I want to introduce Marcel.
Let me see, how do I get it to my computer? If I talk without a microphone, can you all hear me? Loud and clear? Because I'd rather do without, otherwise I'm gonna... So, yeah, all right. So my presentation will be all in a bit. All right. Well, thanks for the introduction, Alfred. I'm really pleased to be here. I feel very flattered that you guys asked me to give this presentation. Like I said in the introduction, I'm my name. I'll do my name. My full name is Marcel Schouwenaar. Friends call me So, you know, if anyone else has got this, please give it a try. Right, so I'm a designer and founder at The Incredible Machine, and we make products for the Internet of Things, and we usually do that for for clients. And for them, we research what opportunities lie there for them to do something with connecting their product or to extend their service into hardware or just get a vision on how to do something meaningful in this field. And we do that in a user-centered and hands-on approach. And I'll tell you all about it because that's what the presentation is about. I'm from the Netherlands, like half of the audience. We're based in Rotterdam. This is like the map of all the IoT companies currently doing cool stuff in Europe, as you see. Rotterdam is not much of a hotspot yet. It will be. London is the place to be, as it seems. And to give you an impression of our office, it's a really nice old orphanage from the 1800s. And this is my team. We're with three guys. We just started 1 year ago, but we already got some nice things going on. I'm there on the left. I'm a TU Delft graduate, industrial design engineering. I do product and UX design, and I'm also a board member for the grant program for the Netherlands for e-culture projects, which is nice. And so where do you put us in the big scope of design studios? We focus on doing concept development for clients and doing a lot of experiments ourselves. And there are two things what we do, two ingredients are like vision and doing concept development. Some of our clients, probably all eyes go to the red square in the top left. Yeah, that's Lego, that's the most awesome client you can ever wish for. It's really awesome to work for. What we do is we merge the physical and the virtual world into one play experience. And they ask us to do as much concept work as possible to get a grip on how to merge these two worlds. That is awesome. We also did some work for Philips, and we also have Ronald, who are here in the picture. But the thing is, the problem with our work is that it's all confidential. We have to sign NDAs for like way into the future. So to show the world what we do a lot of experiments to get, nifty techniques in our hands or just to show off what cool things are possible. And to already give you an impression, I selected one of my favorite projects, which is our So it's just six sensors, wireless radios in the back, and one central unit and the full processor. You can see that my colleague was wrapped up this whole thing. Super secret projects in our man cave that we're doing. This kind of stuff. So okay, what I'm going to talk about today is I'm going to explain our approach to projects, which involves a lot of vision development and making that into tangible concepts. I will go over that in detail, and I'll going to show you a lot of more of these little nifty movies, and hopefully we have a nice discussion afterwards. But first, let me take off this presentation. I actually, if I'm pronouncing things a little weary, or my pronunciation doesn't make sense, it's because my brain's pretty mushy. We just had an 18-hour flight, and we just landed like 4 hours ago. But the thing is, it's really interesting to see how travel, to name this example, changed in the last few years. I mean, you used to go to a travel agency and book stuff, and now all these services are all, you know, they're all on the web. You know, you don't need a travel agency anymore. And then you're going to think about, okay, how did the Internet of Things affect my travel? And then the most shocking thing is, maybe one of the best examples of how IoT changes the world already is an example that's already 40 years old. And that is that I can go anywhere in the world, and I can just pay a little number and a little card that does all the communication, that calls my bank, says, do I have enough balance to do this? Yes, he has. All right, give him the cash, give him the product. We'll settle all the things afterwards. And you know, I went to rural China. I went to the Andes. Everywhere you can just draw cash from the wall. And the thing that's so interesting is that's a really complex system with a lot of stakeholders that's global, that has to deal with so many difficulties in making a reliable service. And then, to me as a user, it's just 6 keystrokes and a little plastic card that makes this possible. And my dream is that, you know, and this is a boring example, there are more exciting things possible, but this is how we want to see IoT develop, that, you know, we make the user interactions, like, we minimize them, we make them good, while there's maybe enormous complex system behind it. So, why is this such a relevant topic? What we think is that IoT is going to change 21st century living. It's going to define the way we're going to live in this century. The web changed the way we interact with services. This is going to change the way we interact with stuff. And we think, you know, we don't know how we're going to do this exactly, but we're taking baby steps. So that's what we're sharing today. And we start with the vision. And now that sounds really heavy for like 3 guys and soldering iron that we're going to talk about vision. So why do we need to talk about this? Is it so just have technology have its way? Just have technology, you know, apply awesome technology on awesome projects and make awesome stuff. But, you know, technology slapping on the internet doesn't always make a good product, like we saw controversy around the Xbox One. What we need is we need strong examples. We need visions we can aspire to as designers, as entrepreneurs, that we can take examples from and move on from. And then really take into account that we're humans interacting with things and that businesses have to make money out of that. And a really interesting example is the geoscope of Buckminster Fuller. He predicted the internet and Google Earth and everything in 1963, how we're going to interact with stuff, and how did he predict that, all that? That's because he approached it from the human value that's in there. But afterwards, I can go all the way into this example. I experience whenever I bring this up, I can go on forever. So we see an importance in coming up with cool visions for this field. And then the second part of my story is why are we making it tangible? There are a few basic reasons why IoT calls for a tangible approach. That is, there are very few design patterns yet how we're going to interact with these connected devices. Because how does what I'm doing here with my Pebble reflect on what's happening in the lighting scheme in my living room when I'm not there? You know, those are new patterns we need to find out. Furthermore, we're going to combine new technologies. We're going to cross time and space borders without You know, we've never thought about these things before because it was never possible, but now it is. And you know, in general, why do we need to make things physical in design? Or, you know, you learn from, when you make things tangible, you can involve people. You know, when I have an idea, I can tell it to people, and they say, awesome idea. When I turn that idea into a physical thing, and I hand it to someone, it says, it's big, it's small, I don't get it, why it's there. So make it tangible. And then, as a designer, when we make stuff, you learn from making. You find out by doing stuff, by taking all the steps and putting stuff together, you're thinking, hey, this doesn't work with this, why doesn't it work? And there are so many reasons behind that. So you learn by doing. And you can communicate across expertise, because I can show it to an engineer. I can show the same prototype to an engineer, or to a business, or to a product manager, or to a user, and to them it all means something else. And they can reflect on it, but it's still the same thing. So I have this idea of what if vision is a problem. Of like the 50 billion connected devices, and healthcare is going to change, this is going to change, that is going to change, and they're on this super high abstraction level. And how do we bring that down to a level that's meaningful for us as designers? And then I ran into this graph and I thought, like, whoa, that's a lot of those. But then I took a closer look, and this was actually making sense, this graph, because it mapped out. We have these horizontals and these verticals, and the horizontals, well, you guys probably all know what they mean, but the horizontals are the technologies and the platforms and the services. They're all emerging now that enable all these IoT ideas. Like we have over there, we have the if this and that as a horizontal, or we have ThingSpeed, or we have Sigfox with their new network, especially for IoT. These will all enable verticals, and these verticals are the specific applications of IoT technology, or technology in general, but IoT technology, to serve a certain end user, or to focus on an application or an application field. And this graph, it was pretty general still. They called the connected home a vertical. The connected home that's pretty broad. But then I thought, like, as a designer, what do I see in this? And I see that, all right, we have this awesome technology, like the tire, for instance, and for some, it has been thought out for certain verticals as the perfect fit. You know, this tire is made for, you know, a wheel. It can be a wheel for a bus, can be a wheel for a car, can be a wheel for a Ferrari, but it's, you know, for a wheel, that's a perfect fit. That's the vertical that's it's interesting for. But where design comes in, there are so many other interesting things we can do with this technology and with these horizontals, so to say. And that's what the exciting time is about. As a designer, there's like a candy shop full of these horizontal solutions and platforms we can build from to apply it to regions or to context where the makers of these platforms never thought. I'm really looking forward to who's the electric input. Yeah, you know, that's a great thing to fool around with. So I've been talking about this vision. So what is it and how are we going to use it? How does it make sense in a design perspective? What I like to see is like a vision to us, it's the word we use if we start a design project that's not about problem solving. We're going to move away from finding a problem and find a solution and call it fixed. No, we're going to create better futures, and a vision is a description of better future. And so how concise can such a description be? This is not a description of a future, but I found the movie pitches in Hollywood pretty interesting. Like, okay, you probably can't see it, it's all the way down the slide. The pitch for Alien in space, no one can hear you scream. Like one sentence and it covers it all. It's like you know exactly what you're going to get. So can we do that to make IoT things, to think of new concepts? And we think, yeah, we can. And we're going to get a little design methodologist here, but try to keep it down to earth. So you want to create a vision for some new context. All right, how are we going to do that? You just take context, for instance, I want to do something for little plastic bricks with studs on it. You know, I take that as a starting point. And I'm going to analyze what's cool about this. I'm going to gather insights. And these insights can be anything. What's so cool about plastic bricks? Who are using these plastic bricks? Who are those? Are those tiny people? Are those adults? Are those children? What's happening in the field around plastic bricks? Are toys changing? Kids are maybe moving towards playing video games instead of playing with Lego. Maybe there are new bioplastics emerging in that field that are going to change the way plastic bricks would look like. Who's paying for the bricks and who's using them? So who wants it, who buys it, who uses it? And which technology and networks are relevant in this context? We're talking about plastic bricks. Should we do something with Facebook, whatever? And then to see what data and information is relevant there. So these are all angles to gather insights for this new context, for this new, for this vision that you want to put together. So how does it work? In practice, so you have a context, it can be anything, it can be, let's see if we can skip this. You know, you take a starting point where you want to focus on and you get out as much insights as possible that are relevant and that are inspiring and that describe what you want to do. And then you bring together the core of what you want to achieve. For instance, we have the little plastic bricks with stuff and we say, you know, we're going to change the way we play with Lego if we can bring the figures to come to life. And that would mean infinite possibilities, and our play would guarantee that there are infinite possibilities to play with to make my own story. And, you know, you're probably familiar with these kind of like spaces that we put around a lot of post-its everywhere. That's how we approach it. But now we add something new to the mix, and that is technology what makes designing for IoT different than designing for other kinds of projects? And then we're gonna bring it down to, if you want to, you're gonna use tech in this project. Know what it is. Know how to use it. Experiment already during your vision process to see, you know, what's cool, what's awesome, what's happening. And then what you're gonna do is you're gonna, you know, you have all these, you gather all these ingredients and you're gonna cook a meal. And I took an example here of the skate park, and I'm gonna show you a little movie later what we actually did for this skate park. So we had these ideas of creating something awesome for a skate park, and we said, if you consider the context of skating, it's not a quantified sport yet, and we can do something awesome with it. And then we observed skaters and what they did and what they talked about, and then we found out skating is it's a social activity. It's not so much as a sport about performing, it's also about hanging around, sharing experiences, and about looking up to people, trying to do a better job or doing a trick or something. And then we also saw these kids filming each other, or parents filming their kids to make awesome movies of their kids doing sick tricks and record their progress. And then we had, quite interesting, we saw a business case for these ideas. If we can get kids to skate, there are cities and skate parks that, you know, can't see enough kids skating and go outside and play. So we hustled this together, and we said, can we provide skaters an opportunity to record their and show off, that's important because it's about show, their progress to becoming the best awesome skater there is. And you know, this is an example of a vision, and now it's pretty easy to turn that into a starting point for coming up with ideas. So we thought, like, hey, can we rig a skate park with RFID scanners and cameras so the skate park knows who is skating in picture, and then provide the skater with a movie of his moves when he gets home. And like I said, I'm going to show you a movie about that later. So now we have this vision, and how can we get to tangible? And we are thinking about getting tangible quick. And I already talked about why to get a tangible, but I think this Feynman quote really illustrates it. You know, what I cannot create, I do not understand. And that's what you're going to do. You're going to understand what you thought of. So we had this vision, and we have a couple of steps how we get from this vision to a product. First, we start with scenarios, because you need to sketch out your idea at one point to get it out, to get it complete. And then we get, like, making it into decreasing steps of abstraction in a proof of concept, a prototype, and a pilot. And so first we start out with doing storyboards and scenarios and writing it down. And we already considered it to be a tangible step, because you can just walk up to an engineer or to a product manager or to a user and say, I'm thinking about this, what do you think about it? And then, you know, you can iterate over that and you can come up with, all right, now we know exactly what we're gonna build. Then the next step is to build a proof of concept. And what we want to do in a proof of concept, we want to cover the whole interaction with the service and the product and the all the technology that you want to use, and do it as fast as possible. Preferably, we only spend one day on this. So we hack together something that allows to feel the whole experience. And another awesome quote of Guy Kawasaki, don't worry, be crap. This is like the crappiest stage what you can do. So an example of a project, the skate project, for what we developed a proof of concept. And this was in a hackathon, but you know, that's an awesome format to do this. So it's a scale model, and there are three entrepreneurs located underneath the scale. I also put cameras. In this stage, we also want to capture the trick, so we had a remote duct tape underneath the scale model. So what it does, it changes the camera angle each time the skater moves, and it also registers the tricks. And this is not done in any of the actual technologies that we were using later on in the process. This is just cheap RFID scanners. It's done in open frameworks, but it gives you the whole experience. And this was tremendously helpful in the process because we got a client right on from this prototype. We had users that found it super awesome and provided us a location wants to demo test this as an actual product. So that was 24 hours well invested. And that's what a proof of concept is supposed to do. After this proof of concept comes the prototype stage. And what makes a prototype different than a proof of concept is that in a prototype, we really want to test out the crucial technologies that we want to use in our product. So we're gonna use that exact RFID reader we need, or we're gonna use we want to use the technologies we're not sure about and getting everything, getting all the critical points solved. And that still can be done quite fast. This is a project we did, like the mega hackathon of 1 week to get to make 5 prototypes in a week. And these were 5 companies who had this idea to do something with IoT. So they made a vision in a couple of weeks, and then in this one day we said, right, we'll take your ideas and turn it into an actual product. And we developed APIs for everything. Everything worked autonomously, so you don't need any computer hidden under a desk or something. And as we speak, 3 of these 5 companies are now moving on with their prototype. One found an investor with this prototype for his project. I cannot disclose exactly what the projects were about, but one is really going to disrupt retail as we know. It's awesome to be part of that for a second. So, and then we had the last stage. Well, the last stage we are involved in as the incredible machine, and that's the pilot. And a pilot is, putting a prototype in a real-life setting and actually have it operate without your interference for a week or 2 weeks, or give it to people to take it home and destroy it in the way that they always seem to do. So we turned the skate park concept into a pilot in which we had 1 week, we had a section of a skate park rigged with ultra high frequency readers, HD cameras, we had the server set up in the park, and we recorded it for 1 week with the kids. And it was awesome to learn from what is happening there and what we did wrong, because we did so many things wrong. Like the camera angles were boring, and the video switched us too early because, they were doing a trick for 15 seconds, and then our system decided, all right, the trick was probably 5 seconds, and then moved on to another shot. And we got a lot of angry kids over us there. But it worked, and we had this was great. Kids loved it. The skate park loved it. We knew which technology we had to fix, and we had to fiddle sad thing is the client ran out of funding, so we're now still waiting for how we get the next step. But it's very, you learn a lot from this. So to drive the point home, what I've been talking about is making visions tangible. We are thinking about taking the next level in as a designer in not solving problems anymore, but now see where we can change the world as we know it. Can we change a context? Can we pick a context that we can bring into the future? And there are so many opportunities. Like there are people now who disrupted the automobile industry here in our room. You know, they didn't fix problems. They just redefined what was happening. And that's what we are ought to do in this field of IoT. And then make it tangible, because as a designer, you have to get your hands dirty and learn from what you're doing, learn from users, and have something that communicates with other people, so you have something to reflect on. And, well, that was my story. I have one final little movie to share, because, you know, movies are the fun part of the presentation. We had this request, or can you give a presentation at this meetup 1 year ago? I should have brought something tangible today, but fortunately it wasn't possible. But we did that for a meetup a year ago, and it was all businessmen. And we thought, oh yeah, how are we going to convince businessmen to talk to, you know, three nerds and soldering iron? And we thought, all right, we'll get them into a game. So we went to the Toys R Us and we bought a Carrera racetrack. You know, the Carrera racetrack, the slot racers. We cut off the controllers, we hooked them up to a computer, and this was the concept we made. So, the faster you best your phone, but also the more people were doing that for your team, the faster the car would go. So this is all, you know, this was the one test drive we did before bringing it to the event. It seemed to work. You know, this is really proof concept idea level. So what happened on the event, on the meetup? It was actually really cool. Because this is all business people now tapping there. Some even getting angrier on each other because they were tapping for they switched team halfway. So I think I gave you a bit of a taste today in what we're doing at the Incredible Machine and how we help companies innovate, but also have a lot of fun getting stuff out of our hands. Yeah, red team one is going to take some work. All right, so I reached the end of my presentation. The reason why I'm here, by the way, in the Bay Area for these 2 weeks is to meet people and to see what's happening here in this area and to connect with people and see if we can maybe do awesome things overseas or exchange ideas. That's it. Thank you for your attention.
So, let's take a few questions for Marcel. Maybe I can start. A lot of us come from a digital background. So maybe programming or just doing interaction design or user experience design. To start making things tangible, like, what's the best way to start? Do you have any like resource or any online resource or books that you can get somebody who's digital to get started?
There's this awesome book, O'Reilly book, it's called Programming Interactivity, which is really nice. It's a really nice book that takes coding as a starting point to get you into physical stuff. Making things talk, often make things smart things. It's a really nice book on the more conceptual level. And well, books are an awesome starting point, but look around at Instructables. There are so many awesome things. It doesn't matter if you have the skills or experience to make things tangible. You just have to have the will to make a thing, because how awesome your idea is, probably someone did something comparable before. It's like Stack Overflow. You can always find the part of your solution to align and then put it together. And it's hacking. Hack stuff. Buy stuff. Hacking.
Awesome. And the author of Smart Things actually is anonymous.
Yeah, I feel very pleased to have you in my audience.
Awesome.
I found it quoted in so many occasions that I had to.
In the beginning, you talked about how you don't really take a problem solution approach, but I think a lot of companies that have physical products don't really think through why their products should be connected to anything, and they think it wouldn't be cool if it turned on a light red or green.
Yeah.
How often do you go back to your clients and say, you need to think through why you're trying to do what you're trying to do and try to focus on what are the core benefits of what you're trying to do?
Exactly. No, that's a very, very good question, because, for instance, with the 5 prototype projects, we did that with all 5 companies. They have been developing their own ideas for a while, and they say, all right, we see this problem in our chain, supply chain, for example, and now we're going to put an RFID scanner here, and now everything is solved. And we said, you started this project with saying you want to create a whole new retail experience, user experience. So what happened to that ambition? And they said, yeah, there are no problems solved there. We could find awesome stuff to do. And we said, no, bring it back. What do you want to achieve? What's happening in retail? You're fighting the bricks and mortar. Shops, it's a brick and mortar shops against the web shops. Like, what's happening there? What do you have your client to offer in this offline world? And and then you go into this process where you really think about what the core values are and what the strengths are you can use, and then you come up with something awesome. And it happens a lot. And with Lego, for instance, we don't have to do it. We have to tow it back, because that's exactly what they asked from us, to come up with this vision. But we experienced in Lego, we moved more and more towards from develop something awesome with this technology to how can we create this experience, or what can we do with this story? And then you have a whole different context. And we find it very, very nice to work on that level with client, because it helps you to get on a conceptual level together and then build up a story from there. By the way, it was Gasper. You were the retail, you were the session leader back then, right?
No, from another
group. He was involved in it. But does that answer your question?
It seems like, I love your definition of vision and kind of turning away from problem solving. It seems so unbounded that it requires some faith and patience, and maybe it doesn't always even work. So how do you operate sort of yourself feeling sane and like you're making progress, and also with your client, whether you were internal or external, you still had a stakeholder that you need to say, it's okay, give me 2 months, something will happen, I swear.
Yeah, well, we're still working on that. I mean, we don't get 2 months. We don't get them. Yeah. So we try to give our clients a taste of how this happens by involving them actually on the spot in this process and getting these insights out together. Thing is, we often do it in our own spare time, or not spare time, but in our own time, to really get the story for their project up. Because a lot of times we have to admit, you're in a client, you're having this discussion, and we say, all right, we know what we're going to do. That let's sketch out this storyboard, and we're done by the end of the day. We're not done yet. And that's a, you know, all our clients are like first timers. You know, we haven't had a second project of our clients yet. So I hope we can do that in our second time. But we have one of the clients. Another retailer where we did all that visioning work ourselves, because they said, we want this goal made. We said, no, that's not going to work. So we haven't gained the trust yet, but we're working.
So your hope is through reputation over time, like, yeah. We've done this with you before, or we've done this for so many years, and there's great things.
Exactly. Just try to. We're trying to. You know, I make a joke myself. I have to admit that we're three nerds and a soul ring hiring, but that's how most people see us. And we still have to move from there to crawl up the value chain. It's a process.
Another question for me. Kubernetes in software being a developer many years ago. Prototyping and actually writing production code is very, very different.
Yeah.
So have you ever been in a situation where you need to work with an engineer to build things for manufacturing and production, and having them switch that mindset into, like, want to get this out in a day, like, let's do this together?
Yeah. No, right. Yeah. We do all our code ourselves.
And even the hardware, like the actual building,
we all do the hardware as well. The back end stuff, the front end stuff, application stuff.
How big is a team usually?
Well, three guys. That's what we want to be. Well, the funny thing is that we actually are now, just before I got on the plane, got here, we finished the project that actually, you know, made it all the way from idea to being in store, or the actual store opening end of this month. But still then, it all goes ourselves. Yeah, that's not. That wasn't super smart, because we should have involved more ends. But for all the prototype stuff, we do everything.
So once that's done, you mentioned a couple times that a lot of that was packed together and it's growing. Have you been involved in the process of turning that over to the development team, and what's that like? Is it, you know, user stories or findings?
In Lego we had our work down to the downstream team, as it's called. They basically re-engineer everything, so they don't take anything off the code, they don't take anything off the schedules, PCB, it's nothing of that. Remains. Even the games we made, we always find them super awesome, and they should make it into a store. Everything is done, again, reinterpreted by this other design team. What we give them is of course the working prototype, so they can play with themselves. We give them a part of our process and insights, and what they also get is evaluation results with the users, and that's done externally by the research, design research firm. So that's what they get, and a presentation. But it's all pretty much on a conceptual level. No hard stuff changing hands.
Let's take two more questions. In the back.
I think there's some interesting connections between IoT and social networking, as far as technology to make connections between people and bridges between physical and virtual. Do you have any thoughts about where you see things going in the next few years? Those are Google's last services.
We are discussing this particular field quite often. Because it's like the elephant in the room, how are these things going to relate to each other? In terms of what we think what's going to happen is that there's more and more going to social networking as we know it now is going to move more towards having having an identity online. That's made up of you and connections to people, and stuff will get an identity too. There's this startup everything based around this notion, and we think you're gonna connect to stuff as well in a network as friends, and things can identify themselves in that network as being, hey, I'm this and that. How does that relate to the social network as you know, like with social interactions? I think they will remain a system in itself. And about Google Glass, I have no clue. I have no freaking clue. So if someone has one laying around, drop me an invite. Oh, but dang, you have one. Oh, okay. Well, still.
One more question?
Either you have a question, but it's more a question to the room.
Okay.
Like, if you hear a story from Marcel, like, if you were considering hiring a team like Marcel's, which I think is an awesome idea, but then my question to you would be, like, what would you expect from that collaboration, and what might be possible reservations, and maybe you can respond to the answers.
Cool.
I think I had a similar question for you, kind of reverse. Like, you're a three-person team. Like, when you spoke about collaboration earlier as being one of the reasons why you're here, like, what element is it, or what type of, like, design thinking approach do you find would kind of add an interesting element to the person?
Oh, wow. That's really awesome. So, that's awesome. Because, yeah, we've been looking into working with more artistic people who are more on the artist side, more experimental. Another side would be people with strong business development skills or strong product management skills,
right,
to really get these ideas embedded in an organization of a client or get it out. I mean, that's really hard as three guys to
A lot of it has, I mean, it's probably got to do with educating clients, alliances. I mean, it's a relatively new paradigm. We have a hard enough time, however, getting clients to understand what that process is like, just creating something that's purely hardware. So to create something that's kind of this new type of device and trying to figure out how they're going to incorporate it into their product line or their strategy has got to be really kind of an educational approach.
Yeah, tell me about it. You're telling, no, seriously, because you're telling a manufacturer 4 years making interiors of shops, physical shops. You're telling them, all right, we now made up this shop that's going to track all the products flowing through your system that's there on your stack, that's shelves, that's moving shelves, that's small or not. Big data analytics on that. Mind was blown. You know, they don't know how to, you know, and we want to learn how to educate or how to involve, you know, how are we going to do this? And that's not, and I think there are other people with way more expertise to do this, and great to work with those people. So, if that, I confirmed what you said. Does that answer your question?
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
We have space to 9, so hang out, cheese, I heard, delicious, converse and connect. And afterwards, we're going to go to the bar, Southern Pacific Brewing, for the after party. It's about 10 minutes walk from here. Yeah, the first person who's not that, I'm going to announce his last name, he's going to be a movie. So thank you for coming. One last thing. One last thing.